How to deal with North Korea. Not only is that in the list of urgent priorities for many countries around the world, it's also one awaiting the U.S. President-elect Donald Trump. From a glimpse into Washington's possible changes in foreign policy vis-a-vis the Korean Peninsula to the latest inside the Hermit Kingdom, our Moon Connyoung spoke with Rudiger Frank, a world-renowned North Korea expert and author of 38 North.
It's been a year since we met in Abu Dhabi. A lot has happened, right, on North Korea front as well. But first, let's start with what happened in the last few days. So Donald Trump has been elected as the U.S. president. Does that in any way change the equation regarding North Korea?
Oh, I think it definitely does. The risk of a confrontation has risen because Mr. Trump, according to what he said so far, would be willing to do something very bold, which could include a military conflict. But also the risk for a big breakthrough in terms of cooperation has also, the chance has grown, because Mr. Trump would actually be a person who is willing to forget about the past, sit down with Kim Jong-un and talk. It could go both ways. The risk has increased, but also the chances for an improvement have also grown.
Like you mentioned, there have been two nuclear tests by North Korea since we last met last year, and the UNSC has yet to really issue or adopt sanctions with regards to the latest nuclear tests and provocations. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think Mr. Clapper of the CIA actually nicely summarized it. He said, you know, we've come not very far by trying to get rid of the North Korean nuclear program completely. So perhaps we should stop by trying to put a cap on it, like limiting it. And this means talks and negotiations, and perhaps sanctions are not really a good start for that. In addition, of course, I think at some point we have reached a limit of what international sanctions can achieve short of a military intervention. And also the Chinese willingness to cooperate with those sanctions is limited for a number of reasons. So I think we need a new approach, and that new approach might be acknowledging reality, talks, normalization, and then trying to see how where we can go from there.
As an observer and an expert on North Korean affairs, what is your latest finding observation vis-a-vis North Korea?
Well, the latest observation obviously is related to the 7th Party Congress, which was a major breakthrough event, the first one after 36 years. What we now see much clearer is Kim Jong-un's strategy, at least for the midterm, which is a return to a new normal. It is ending that period between the mid-1990s and around 2010-11, when North Korea was an extraordinary situation, where we had the Songun policy, and where we had almost no functioning of the party institutions. He wants to go back to, let's say, the mid-late 1980s. But so far, I think we have a much better understanding of the overall strategy of Kim Jong-un. And that's a big progress if you compare it to 2 or 3 years ago, where we were just wondering what he is going to do.
And last but not least, the chances of unification of the two Koreas. Do you see a more likeliness towards a reunification possibility?
Well, I think the chances for unification are as good or as bad as ever. Certainly the factors either contributing or preventing it might change a little bit. But in principle, the international situation is the same. I don't think that, except the two Koreas, and even there I'm not sure, not too many countries are interested in a Korean unification, which is a big problem. What we can learn from history is that unification can happen very, very quickly and in a very unpredictable way. So I think no matter how we evaluate the chances, I think it's important to be prepared, because it could happen any time or only 20 years from now, but that we will only know when it happens.